to welcome you to another Index in Transformation seminar. We're very pleased to have Professor Brenda Chalfen from the Department of Anthropology and the Center for African Studies at the University of Florida. Thank you and welcome. We've already had a session with the honors students around a couple of the publications, and you will find it really interesting. She trained, got a PhD at University of Pennsylvania, and is working currently on a book called Vital Politics, Infrastructures of Bear Life on Urban Ghana's Frontier. And now Brenda has a number of other publications, Neoliberal Frontiers, an Ethnography of Sovereignty in West Africa, published in 2010, Chia Butter Republic, State Power, Global Markets, and the Making of an Indigenous Commodity, in 2004, and we're very pleased to have you here to take us through your current work, and we're looking forward to a probably 40-minute presentation followed by discussion. Thank you.
Thanks so much. I'm really pleased to be here. It's only been in the past year that I got to know both Bernard Dubelle and Stephen Robbins, although I've been following their work, and just the conversations have been so fruitful. So it's really exciting to finally be at Stellenbosch and to get to know the students and some of the other faculty members. And we're really trying to generate a sustainable partnership between University of Florida and our Center for African Studies, Department of Anthropology, and your program. So I'm really going to welcome your input and questions about my own work, but I also just encourage you to be in touch if you want to know more about UF and our program and different opportunities, because already just a very rich dialogue has taken off. So what I'm sharing today is from a book project, a project that I feel like, oh, I should have this all together. It's a lot of different pieces. The title of the manuscript is, as Stephen mentioned, Vital Politics, Infrastructures of Bear Life in Urban Ghana. But I'm really dealing with vital politics and this thing that I'm still kind of working to get my head around, of vital publics. And what is the public, and when is the public political, and when is it not, and why is it not? And the book draws from my research in Ghana. I have a long-standing kind of research investment relationship working in various parts of Ghana. This project is situated in a coastal city in Ghana called Tema. It's a port city. It's a planned city to look at the arrows. It's actually quite a fascinating city in terms of post-war modernism. The city was a brainchild of Ghana's president, liberation leader, Kwame Nkrumah, in association with Konstantinos Doxiadis, who was a very well-known Greek urban planner. He planned cities around the world. Tema was one of them, Islamabad, Baghdad, Riyadh, parts of Lusaka, parts of Nigeria. He was prolific in the 1960s and early 1970s, and he struck up this relationship with Nkrumah. It's a moment of decolonization, there's funds, there's vision, and the intention is to build the model city, a city that really projected the best possibilities of Ghana in terms of its industrialization, as well as its extroversion with trade and a big port. It's tied to the hydroelectric dam and an aluminum smelter. So this was kind of a mega product, a high modernist project. So the city itself is quite interesting. And so here's just some literature from kind of the rollout and the initial promotion of Tema. And I went to Tema to do research, and I really found it both fascinating and overwhelming. Too big, too complicated, too much going on. How could I encompass it as an anthropologist? But there were certain connections and pieces and things that I started to see that kind of came together. And this wasn't the above ground architecture that was of such great interest to Doxiadis and others, but it was below ground, the infrastructure of sewage and sewage systems. And Temma was remarkable for its underground gravity-based sewage system. This is late 50s, early 1960s, and a sewage system was built that was modeled on Los Angeles with long, long sea outfalls and private toilets in every single home. Temma was organized for an array of classes. There were actually different 11 different housing types. Each housing form, each dwelling type had a private toilet that linked to the citywide sewage system. So these are actually some of the original maps. And the original maps, even though it's a blueprint and it's supposed to be reproduced, the original maps are kept as some kind of sacred document that marks the origins of the city. So my book looks at different parts of the city of Temma. The central part of the city, which I call Temma proper, where this revolutionary, cutting edge at the time, underground sewage system was based, and these areas kind of within and surrounding the core of the city, where alternative forms of sanitary provisioning were provided by the municipal authorities, but many of them have emerged from within the communities, the residents who were not provided for by the urban authorities or in the original plans. So my book addresses four different parts of Temma. So there's Temma proper, and that part of the book is really about the breakdown of a system that has been barely maintained over 50 years, and what do people do when the sewage mains break and the pumping station loses its power? How do they contend? Other parts of the city are Temma Mania, which is a resettlement area where the original inhabitants of what was a fishing village were removed to make room for the plant city, so it's a resettled area. Students from this morning's seminar read a piece about the toilets, these communal toilets that were built for the community that was resettled, but kind of barely maintained over the years, and so the community has kind of gone back to revive them and to claim them. Another part of the city is an area that I call Wastelandia, and this is a wetland from a lagoon that feeds into the sea, but because of industrialization in the area, it's been choked, the lagoon has died and dried up, and there's a dumping of waste there, of garbage, to stabilize the area, and a waste entrepreneur has built a huge public toilet as along with a hostel and a biogas facility, very interesting. I've written about that in a journal called Ethnos. Today, I'm going to focus on a case study from Ashima, and I'll tell you a little bit more about Ashima. But what I'm dealing with is in some ways similar, but also different from the kinds of sanitary politics, poo protests, et cetera, that we see in the Cape Town area. And those were the initial conversations that got Steve and I talking about things. And so I do hope we come back to, well, what's similar? Okay, so why is waste a kind of pivot of public participation, public agitation, negotiation with municipal authorities? But how does it operate differently? How does it operate differently given the very different histories of government in the area, given the very different histories of relationships with the state, very different kinds of urban policies, and just a different political consciousness within the two different locations. So Ashima is a part of Ghana. It's on the outskirts, not of Ghana, of Temma. It's on the outskirts of Temma. it's considered kind of a bedroom community, or I jokingly call it a bathroom community. Ashima is where the people who came to Tema, when Nkrumah had this grand idea, we're going to build a port, we're going to build a railroad, we're going to build a new city. People flocked to Tema because of all the opportunities. A lot of laborers came, people came with families, without families, and they settled. But when it was time to kind of clear the area to build the city, the planning authorities refused to provide them housing in Mania, the resettlement area. Those who were considered migrants and this category of northerners, they were just pushed out and they were trucked to this area about 6 miles away called Ashima. And this was really kind of, to some extent, to borrow a South African term, almost like a labor reserve for Tema. No housing was provided. When they knocked down this older fishing village to move people to Mania, they took the used zinc sheets and they loaded them up with the people in the trucks and brought them to Ashima. So people were dumped as if they were garbage with garbage within this area. Years later, half a century later, it is a thriving urban area. It's an area that was always neglected by the municipal authorities. And through that neglect, has become very, very resourceful and very successful in terms of self-organization, because a lot of people were migrants. They stayed very close to their kind of ethnic kin. There are a lot of community associations. And despite the neglect of the municipal authorities, they became very efficient at providing for themselves in terms of building houses and even building public toilets for themselves. In 2008, Ashima gained autonomy as a municipality. So it's a kind of a breakaway republic. It was there to kind of prop up Tema, but over the years, due to this neglect and dismissal, people in Ashima became very savvy about fighting for their rights. And in 2008, it gained status as an autonomous municipality. And this was quite a coup. Pierre Ibrahim Badu was one of the leaders of this. He eventually became the mayor. So there are all sorts of political opportunities that became possible. But there are also a lot of constraints because municipalities need resources. And they didn't have very many resources. Because of this, things like urban sanitation emerged as kind of a key realm of negotiation and also experimentation. How can this municipality where the residents and the leaders kind of balked at the maltreatment by Tema's municipal authority in terms of the provision of public goods and public services, how was it going to provide? Here we have a picture of public toilets. The government eventually in the 90s, people had bucket latrines or pan latrines in households, and there was a new environmental sanitation policy in Ghana in the late 90s, or sometime in the 90s, and bucket latrines, pan latrines were outlawed. And so there were about 25 public toilets built by the government to serve a population of about 250,000. So they were highly inadequate. So alongside those government toilets that are pretty unpleasant places, private households started to provide public facilities, especially well-off households. I write about that in my book. I'm not going to talk about that now. Maybe we can go back to this. But you can see how municipalities try to raise revenue from waste. So the second image here has to do with the fees, the tariffs, the taxes that these public toilet providers are charged, along with taxes for other things, such as peto and palm wine. So the story today starts with a different set of sanitary experiments. And this takes off around 2008-2010. With the rise of the UN MDGs, the Millennial Development Goals, and then these have been kind of reiterated, expanded, more recently in the 2015 Sustainable Development Goals, there's been a big, big focus on WASH, water, sanitation, and hygiene, with big public and environmental health campaigns, and a great deal of investment and interest among NGOs and other sanitary service providers. So this is just an image from an office block where several of these different companies, NGOs are located. And then also this is the actual sanitation plan from the municipality of Ashima. Well, what do they intend to do? Who are their partners? What are they going to spend? When are they going to spend it? Today, I'm going to focus on the work of Share, which is an international NGO turned private utility that's currently in operation in Ashima. I'm actually going back to Ghana in a few days, and I'm going to check up on how things are going. Share stakes its fortune on the large-scale conversion of organic waste into electrical power through the workings of a massive biodigester. With the blessings of the municipal government and the backing of the African Development Bank, the idea is that energy is going to be generated from the accumulated fecal matter of the urban underclass, and then it's going to be sold back to them via the national grid. So I call this an excreta to energy project, E2E. From my perspective, or from an anthropological or theoretical perspective, I think it really speaks to the work of Georges Bataille, who has this notion of a general economy. So for Bataille, instead of an economics that's based on scarcity, Bataille looks at human material life in terms of waste. What is spent, what is squandered, what is left over, or what is rendered unusable. And Bataille is very much, he's writing in the 40s, 50s. He is inspired by the laws of thermodynamics. There's a lot of kind of experimentation with nuclear energy, et cetera. When he's writing, there's kind of a whole scientific backstory to his social theory. But he's very focused on this idea of excess, that all economic activity generates some kind of excess, and that excess is ultimately a form of energy. It can be expended productively or unproductively. It can fuel growth. It can drive some kind of exuberant display. But this is all in the thrall of an irrecuperable loss. So this is his notion of the accursed share. In this situation I encountered in Ghana, within Ashima, I saw that waste harvesting was providing surplus value and all sorts of kind of accolade and notice for some, all the while it was intensifying the alienation and the expropriation of the not quite human natures of bodily waste. Among many other excremental infrastructural experiments of its kind that's being enabled by the reorientation of development goals as well as allied financial instruments. And I don't really talk so much about the financial instruments, but it's a big part of what allows these projects to happen. There's a big focus on pro-poor growth. There's a big focus on sustainability. But the public good is not always served. In a lot of ways, this is a kind of necropolitics, from the words of Mbembe, a kind of politics, as he puts it, that transcends and disorients the idea of limit, a politics that subjugates life to the power of decay. So maybe we're going to call this a FICO politics. So Charest's alchemy of energy and excremental excess began innocently enough. They wanted to build about 60 new public toilets in Ashima. So this, they're working on a new public toilet. They're rehabbing, in this picture, an older public toilet. But the problem was they were gonna build these 60 toilets, they were gonna make a centralized sewage system. The problem was there wasn't enough space. They couldn't find enough room to build these new toilets. So they kind of reordered their goals and their methods. Rather than building these toilets, they were going to focus on this infrastructure of waste conversion through this massive biodigester. And this hinged on a kind of experimentation, building an experimental apparatus and performing experimental trials. Although the inner city of Ashima, there's no property available in the inner city, there was a little used agricultural station on the outskirts of town. And this is where Charest set up its workspace. And this was located on lands held by the Ghana Irrigation Authority. It had once been celebrated as a space of agricultural productivity and agricultural promise and food sovereignty, and you're gonna have rice production right at the edge of this urban area. But that was no longer in the realm of possibility. There was this new, what I call general economy of waste, borrowing from Bataille, taking hold, and it was gonna exceed the promise of the productive economy of rice production. And instead it became a place for waste harvesting and knowledge harvesting. So I first visited this location, this outpost, in 2012, soon after it was established. And I think we can call it a laboratory in the field, to borrow from science studies scholars like Robert Kohler. And it combined the intentionality of a lab with the naturalism of a field site, all in the pursuit of for-profit outcomes. This facility was devoted to a kind of iterative knowledge production, a kind of controlled comparison, all the while incorporating and sometimes orchestrating the messy realities of real people and places. This site consisted of a fenced 2-acre plot, a small office block, a few agricultural beds, some fertilizer drying platforms, and an underground installation of pipes, chambers, tanks, switches, and gauges. Most important, there were two low-water, pore-flush toilets and one cistern toilet. At the heart of the research station, the toilets would feed two biodigesters for the production of usable methane gas. Chinese dome-style tanks were built by professionals from Ghana's University of Science and Technology, and they were deliberately small in size, so the staff could better monitor the ratio of inputs to outputs in the conduct of their research trials. And there's something about the site manager drew the shape of this dome tank for me, and it's always just kind of made an impression. And I also just want to convey that these were miniatures, and that's part of their promise or potential as kind of an experimental apparatus. the toilet customers near the research station were very eager to use the water closets. And it was patronized by maybe 100 people or so a day. They paid about 10 cents each. And they prodded the managers to expand the facility. Because you know, there'd be a rush in the morning and the evening. Couldn't there be more toilets than just these two or three? But the team at Charest resisted the idea of adding more seats. At this early stage, their mission, frankly, was scientific. It was geared to data collection, not profit. They were all about getting the recipe right, and I'll let you know what that means in a minute. There was interaction between the managers and the customers, but this kind of socializing was really an exercise in didactic role modeling. Ben, the site manager pictured here, explained that waiting time was going to be put to use to educate customers about proper toilet use, hand washing, and water conservation, as well as to collect their feedback and recommendations. Given the tendency of customers to queue early in the morning, the staff found this a particularly opportune time to coach them about the proper use of the facilities. It didn't matter who used the toilet, just that they used it correctly. Customers were there to activate the apparatus. Customer satisfaction was of much less an interest than the volume and composition of their bodily outputs. In crude terms, persons were equal to the waste they produced. However, all waste was not equal. In Charest's research balance sheet, human excrement was a central, though not singular, input in a larger recipe for energy production. A defining innovation of Charest's transaction of waste to energy and back again was a combination of different types of organic excess: human waste, fruit and vegetable waste from the market, and offal from the slaughterhouse. So in the apparatus of the biodigester, these varied inputs would together form a kind of intermediary essence that generated energy and in turn capital through its sale to power companies and eventually to consumers. So in this slide, I'm playing with some of the ideas of geographer, Marxist geographer, Vinay Gidjwani. And he suggests that we look at the waste value dialectic and to kind of look at this in relation to a classic capitalist dialectic outlined by Marx. So I think there's a three-sided transaction going on, from waste to energy to money, or that M could be C for capital. I may have been missing a W there. To waste again, to more energy, to more money capital, and on and on and on. Because this is the intention, this is the logic of this apparatus. And in the transformation of multiple forms of waste into energy, and then capital, a large part of the work of Charest managers and technicians was all about getting this recipe right and determining the best combinations of human waste, animal waste, market waste, to maximize energy productions. And they were doing these small batch experiments. I saw one that had a mix of animal waste, toilet waste, and water. Another was food waste and human waste. And they would take note of the input, the output, how much energy, how much time, how much fertilizer was all being produced. And getting these proportions right and getting the data correct was one reason the Charest staff was so exacting in their monitoring and advice to toilet customers. It was critical that each user flush their waste with a 2.5 liter measure of water, so the mix would be the proper volume and the proper consistency for biodigestion. So in addition to the work site's dual use as laboratory and field site, customers were effectively enrolled in this project as research subjects and laboratory technicians. They had to monitor their outputs, their inputs within the apparatus. And this was a rather self-conscious endeavor with this adjustment and feedback to the customers. I see this as I do some reading around sustainability science and science studies, that there are other projects going on elsewhere in the world around urban science and sustainability science, where the city, the urban landscape, is enrolled within the research project. So Evans and Carvonen talk about this in terms of efforts to mix the conceptual infrastructure of science as well as empiricizing the urban landscape. Here, I think they're also instrumentalizing urban dwellers. This is creating a controlled, bounded environment that relies on measurement, expertise, and the staging and restaging of simplified versions of much more complex social realities. It also turns infrastructure into scientific instrument, and scientific instrument into infrastructure. To keep the system going, it was necessary to burn or release the methane produced. The Chiray staff reminded residents to come and use the gas that had been conveniently diverted to a pipe and brazier right near the entrance to the work site. The solid byproducts from the digester were going to be used and tested as an organic fertilizer. And the Chiray manager talked with pride about the efficiency of this waste value chain. However, there was a little fly in the ointment of experiment. The city waste management official who accompanied me to the site wasn't really that impressed. He also knew that these were his competitors, even though they were supposed to be his partners. And he kept talking about flies that were on the fertilizer drying beds. The site manager quickly explained this away as a kind of byproduct of the food waste they were using to accelerate the decomposition in the waste chamber, voicing a microbiopolitics, and this is a term that Heather Paxson uses in her look at artisanal cheesemakers, but I think it's a very useful term here. This kind of microbiopolitics about the flies in the waste was much more a struggle over inclusion and struggles around understandings of public health. The city inspector warned that flies were a source of maggots in the toilet chamber and a sure harbinger of poor hygiene. There are other sorts of politics at play. In a location that was coded as state lands, the government had a benign, largely background presence that rendered Chiray's activities official. Though not a fully public realm, the area and the toilet was billed as a public service. So I'm going to move to phase two of the project. It's like a harnessing municipal power. When I returned to Ashima a year later, after I had that first encounter out at the ag station, I was looking at urban waste elsewhere in the city, but I kept running into the Chiray staff. And I was trying to figure out, why were they there? Why were they in town, out and about, not at the research station? Well, what had happened, the city had shifted for Chiray within their experiment. The city had shifted from a site of experimentation to the actual subject of experiment, moving from a direct relationship between the Chiray staff and the individual sanitary subjects within this dedicated research station. Phase two invoked an indirect relation between the company and the urban residents en masse, mediated by the municipal authorities by means of waste. After analyzing the results at the research station to determine the most energy efficient stew of human, plant, and animal waste, Chiray's next goal was to ascertain the composition of urban organic discards in real terms in order to calculate the inputs actually available for the large scale biodigester that they sought to build. Once they knew how much plant and animal waste could be had in a given time frame, they could figure out how much human waste they would need to harvest to add to the mix. This problem had to be approached on an urban scale and required not just the tacit approval and background presence of the urban authorities, but their active participation. And this took place in a very different urban space, a very public urban space, really was quite different from the what we would call the closed commons of this peri-urban agricultural station. This was Ashima's dump, but it's actually, it's a waste transfer station. All the garbage from the city goes here first. It's brought here, it's picked over. There's both a formal and informal economy of waste here. Making official what might be called in Weberian terms the state's monopoly of waste, and this is according to Ghana's 1999 environmental sanitation policy, municipal and district assemblies had the ultimate authority over the disposal and handling of waste, both solid, which is trash, and liquid, which is excreta. So this policy states that the control and ownership of waste goes to the district assembly, to the municipal authority. And Charest took full advantage of this. They simultaneously employed and reworked the terms of the municipal accountability for urban waste matters, along with seeking free access to the waste materials under the municipality's aegis. Charest essentially put the municipality to work on its behalf. Charest used its new perch at the waste transfer station as a gateway to other public areas under city control. Carrying out Charest's request, representatives from the city's waste division instructed their crews to separate organic and non-organic waste from the materials brought to the dump from the city's open-air markets. And so in that letter a couple slides back, that's the order. Please cooperate. You're expected to do this. Making waste conspicuous in this way was an arduous task. It involved laying out tarps, dumping a truckload of refuse, sorting organic and non-organic materials into piles, putting them into separate bins, and weighing them. The supervisors from Charest recorded the results, and they compared the findings from different markets, different days, different times of the week to get a sense of output. So there is a kind of de facto diarchy of Charest and municipal waste managers. Waste was emerging as a form of urban property, partable, aggregatable, and with separate rights of access, use, and disposal, and even the right to know what waste consisted of. Combining the extraction of labor, because these workers, these municipal workers, were enrolled in this process of weighing and sorting, so there's an extraction of labor and a kind of scientific research going on at the dump. Those involved, these guys involved, jokingly called the work BOLA learning, and BOLA in tree means waste. They also refer to it as garbage university. And they were poking fun at the seriousness of these young urban waste professionals who were directing the sorting efforts. And occupying the fuzzy boundary between work and research, their Charest representatives called it a training exercise. Holding master's degrees in environmental and development studies from the UK, these were forward-looking young professionals. And when they talked about this whole idea of bio-waste generation, I couldn't help but think that they were referring to themselves. Demonstrating, again, Bataille's core insights, under the umbrella of Charest's experimental quest, waste was becoming an avid object of acquisition. Containing the seeds of multiple forms of value, it was not yet a commodity, but a type of gift or urban booty. Transferable, it demonstrated the state status as both free to give and free to waste waste. Yet, unanticipated in Bataille's model, freely taken and used profitably by Charest, waste transfer by means of waste science was a threat to the municipal authorities' assumed right. So let me go on to the last phase of the project. Phase three, I call this seeing like a biodigester. So here we are at Charest's eventual installation, the next part of its project. A year later, Charest's E2E pipe dream was on its way to becoming a reality. They had the a million euro loan from the African Development Bank African Water Facility. And this was a special grant scheme promoting sustainable access to improved water and sanitation. I see this as a kind of post-economic crisis development finance, a kind of junk bond of development aid. And ADB made it explicit that their interest in sanitation was all about leveraging waste. They said that for every $1 million spent, investment in sanitation attracts another $20 million. So maybe there were noble motives here, but there was also a very shrewd economic logic behind it. With the million euro loan, Charest's plan for the large-scale biodigester could finally go ahead. Connected to a generator, the methane produced would be converted to electricity, sold to the Accra Electric Company at a preferential tariff, would then be purchased by the Electric Corporation of Ghana to be sold to consumers. The remaining organic residues would be composted and put on the market as fertilizer for agricultural enterprise. So there was this near perfect loop demonstrating the promise of green capitalism. As Charest saw it, the useless would be made useful, cost transformed into profit, and the noxious pollutant would become a source of pleasure and productivity. From laboratory experiment to field training exercise, Charest had become a bona fide business enterprise. It was a very neat package on paper. But of course, the realization of the scheme on the ground was rife with its own contradictions, contingencies, and bottlenecks. Moving from a development agent to corporate entity, Charest's work took on a strongly proprietary cast. The municipal government, while deemed a partner on paper, was in practice reduced to one stakeholder among many. Yet they had earlier promised Charest access to an expansive area that had been zoned decade earlier for sewage settling ponds that had never been built. So this is where Charest cited its E2E plant. This included the massive biodigester, massive waste storage tanks, drying beds, effluent runoff fields, pumps, siphons, generators, transformers, and power lines. Once construction was underway, the head of the city's environmental health division found himself unwelcome, only permitted to visit by appointment, the site surrounded by barbed wire with a security gate and security guard. But this was all fine according to the MOU Charest and the mayor had signed. Essentially a BOOT, I'm sure you're familiar with this terminology, a build, own, operate, and transfer agreement, the municipality was due to inherit the power plant within 18 years. This was so, this is all absolutely true. I am still kind of dumbfounded. This was so despite the fine print of the ADB project contract, noting this waste treatment experiment is expected to have a useful life of 15 years. Okay, you see there's a problem here, so we're still gonna count and see what happens. But basically, the city was gonna inherit this when it had become a waste site of its own. Despite the exclusion experienced by public officials, the installation had an assured public presence. There had been considerable deliberation about what sort of biodigester to build. Departing from the Chinese dome of the experimental works, an entirely different system was selected. Known as an eco bag, it essentially consists of a pit that's sealed with an expandable airtight PVC tarp. The volume and the height depend on the amount of waste fed into the digester and the amount of methane produced. Eco bags is considered relatively easy to install. It's much less expensive than the cost of the bricks and the mortar and the reinforced steel of the Chinese dome tank. Most of these eco bags are built to much smaller specifications. So there were some concerns about the size, but with the tropics, again, a kind of attractive laboratory for innovation and experimentation, the exception was deemed workable given the favorably high ambient air temperature that could be found in Ghana year-round. The Charest representatives considered the long, shallow shape of the EcoBag, a perfect fit for the unbuilt sewage treatment ponds. This time, turning a business proposition into an unexpected science experiment, despite their earlier on-site testing, once the installation was underway, the contractor ran into problems. The area quickly turned muddy. The site had to be re-engineered with a sub-reservoir and a retaining wall and a 3-meter-high cement platform. Blowing the budget, the adjustment also blew the project's cover. The expansive green dome of the EcoBag was now highly visible, large, looming, and remote, a symbol of a capacious, if distant, public authority. Beside the biodigester's looming visibility, the enlarged scope of the project claimed a much more intrusive public presence. The MOU with the municipal authority formally authorized Charay to collect both fecal matter and solid waste from the municipality, yet human waste was the preferred input. Thus, Charay cut a deal with ASHMA, the municipal authority, to claim access to the waste deposited in the city's existing public toilets. Charay's earlier research indicated the importance of what it called high-quality fecal materials. According to the project foreman, it had to be fresh, that means less than 2 weeks old, as well as 100% chemical-free. At once instrumentalizing and infrastructuralizing the waste-producing body, public toilet customers were imagined to be conduit, producer, and manager of fecal matters. The project documents said that the collection of high-quality waste was a critical success factor for the rollout of the plan. And there was a strong kind of interest in a program for hygienic waste behavior change campaigns, the training of public toilet operators, incentivizing supplier service contracts, all in the pursuit of acceptable sanitary conditions and outputs. And this is just an image of some of these kind of repurposed public toilets where some of this kind of hygiene campaigns are going on to get the right kind of waste. Now, one wonders about the implications of these qualifications and quantifications for the waste-producing body. Here, Bataille's insights regarding waste as a source of rank may be relevant anew. Are Ashaiman's public toilet users to be divided into high and low quality and quantity waste producers? Will those who waste more and those who waste best earn social prestige? Would certain public toilets and those who patronize them be accorded status and recognition due to the quality of their fecal outputs? Would there emerge from this equation a class of super shitters or super citizens, blue ribbon public toilets, and the like? Perhaps it is a more forthright Marxian optic that reveals the stakes of this scenario and the ethical implications of the cycle of profit and expenditure, production and reproduction, work, consumption, and super exploitation surrounding Charay's E2E experiment. Bataille, in Visions of Excess, which is another important work of his, quotes Marx in saying, in history as in nature, decay is a laboratory of life. Could this be rephrased to assert decay is the new laboratory of capital? Is the urban underclass in this equation reduced to fecal suppliers, a privilege they pay for when they use a public toilet and pay for again when they consume the energy that is produced from their very own waste? Is waste harvesting, like organ harvesting, discussed by scholars such as Nancy Shepherd Hughes, now becoming one of the very few productive outlets available to this urban underclass? These questions still remain to be answered. But we can look at how the realities of the E2E project measure up to these speculations. When I visited the station last July, the biodigester was prime with cow manure and market waste that the market women were collecting for the company for free. Charay had completed a survey of the city's public toilets and were trying to figure out the best suppliers, assessing the best volume and best quality to add. Nevertheless, the system was operating at a reduced scale. The project foreman, whom I had met years earlier during a waste sorting exercise, showed me around the biodigester site, taking pride in the complex operations and how far they had come since the experiments back in the rice fields. at the far edge of the installation, away from the muck of the drying beds and the effluent ponds, were two electrical generators, a little bit hard to see. One was low voltage, the other high voltage. And the high voltage led into the electric company's high tension lines that worked right on the other side of the fence, moving into the power line to the national grid, and from there into the homes and appliances of ordinary citizens. This complex yellow box of the generator was a kind of holy grail where the E2E promise was realized. As the foreman pointed out the components and explained the operations, I sensed a mix of pride and a kind of wistfulness that took me by surprise. Perhaps dealing with his own sense of loss or his own alienated efforts, he said it was unfortunate that the customers, the consumers, couldn't see or know that they were part of the process, that they were somehow present in this all-powerful substance of electricity. It was as if all the work, the knowledge, the relationships, the careful chemistry of cow dung, market waste, and human feces, the admixture of water, the timing of release, had all been reduced to an anonymous force, condensed into a vast grid with no name, mark, or even smell. So that's the picture of Charest. I'm just going to wrap up a couple of final thoughts. So, and this is kind of in relation to what I'm imagining is perhaps some of the concerns of indexing transformation. So what kind of transformation does this case index? What are the conditions of its possibility? What is it making possible? So there are a few things here that I think are really critical to keep in mind in terms of the larger implications of this project. One links up with the work of Jason Moore, who's a sociologist, and he has quite a fascinating book called Capitalism and the Web of Life. He talks about capitalism as a world ecology, and I think this is partaking of that very logic. He talks about capitalism appropriating uncapitalized nature and redrawing the boundary between the human and the extra-human. I think this is absolutely happening, and it's happening via urban bodies and urban spaces in the global south. But what are the political conditions as well as the political contradictions of this arrangement? One thing that I'm really trying to puzzle over, and it strikes me as very suggestive, is how this hinges on the state's monopoly of waste. And what kind of monopoly is this? And how does the state's purported or assumed monopoly of waste indicate a certain right to the city, the right to waste, the right to urban waste? And what if this right, a right that we assume is held or claimed by municipal and state authorities, actually becomes challenged or usurped by capital? So this is two things I think are important takeaways here. The state's monopoly of waste. But we look typically at the right to the city as a subaltern problematic. But maybe the right to the city is actually problematic or a concern for municipal authorities themselves. But there are other elements in what I think of as a kind of political lattice that sustains experiments like this. There's a network of governance and non-governance. And what's very, very important here is the way this gets legitimated and enabled by science, and especially sustainability science, which we often take as at face value as participatory science, as good science, as proper science. But how does it align itself with capital in sometimes surprising ways? And the other piece here that I've just kind of mentioned but not really gone into are the kind of heterodoxies of post-crisis development finance that also enable these sorts of investments and experiments. So I'm going to leave it at that, and I welcome your questions and input.
Thanks very much, Brenda. So let's take three or four questions at a time. People have to leave at 2, that's always the case, but we've got time until 2:30.
Okay.
Any comments, questions? Rob, and we'll take 3, so. And if you could just introduce yourself briefly, thanks.
Hi, my name is Rob, and I work in the department. I really enjoyed the presentation. A question about, most for instance, when you're talking about the creating a kind of society of super jitters, and in terms of and talking about health campaigns going on to get people to produce the right kind of weights. And I wondered, you know, if that's something the health campaigns, does that, how wide are these health campaigns and how restricted? I mean, do they happen in schools, for example? I was thinking, you know, in terms of healthy shitting, do you require to eat a healthy diet in order to produce healthy shit? Well, no, you know, good shit for producing weight, for producing power, methane and stuff, or is it better to eat, you know, unhealthily? Or, you know, I mean, contradiction. That's one thing I'd like to know about a bit. And also, I was just kind of interested in you know, this kind of work about transforming waste into something, you know, kind of efficient, you know, part. And is it something that happens in rich countries? You know, and does it take, and if so, does it take different forms? And you know, I was thinking, you know, Donald Trump about the draining the swamp and stuff and draining the sewer and kind of, you know, are there examples of trying to thinking along the lines of, you know, creating making waste efficient in those countries and do the taking things.
Okay.
Should take a few
other questions or comments or we could go and David?
And
the third one.
I think I'm interested in what in general in the relationship between how public authority is formed and then the relation to the notion of citizenship. So I was actually interested in when you were talking about this state monopoly of waste, but in this context where Shaima is also has this history of self-organization. So in a way, sort of public authority there, it's de facto fragmented, so the state is only one of the actors, and then how capitals plays in once sort of this become a resource. So I'm really wondering if you can elaborate more on the underlying idea of citizenship, if you may.
Yes. Sure.
Thank you very much for your presentation.
Could you introduce us?
Well, I'm John Sani. I'm a doctoral student in the philosophy department. What concerns me is the moral dimension of all this. And what are the moral considerations for granting loans, for instance? Like the loan you talked about. It was about, is it 100 million?
This was €1 million.
€1 million.
And it wasn't a loan, it's just a grant. So they just gave them money. Yeah.
Yeah. So what are the moral considerations that are on ground for such grants to be awarded? Yeah. So, yeah.
Okay, a lot of very good questions, some of which I can't answer. So I don't know about all the health campaigns going on. So I've been kind of following this sporadically, and I do want to go back because it was just getting up and running last year, and so now they're really trying to figure out, can they get their 25 tons of waste per day to produce, because it's such a huge apparatus. But there is a certain, irony, you could put it in those terms. Apparently, if people have diets very high in meat, then their fecal materials don't break down as easily, and they're not as efficient for a biodigester. So given that this is a rather poor municipality, it's really a working class municipality. There's a lot of upward mobility, but it's definitely a working class municipality. People for the most part don't have meat-rich diets. So they're very sort of, I'm not gonna say objection, but the limited means that are available to them, their own poverty makes them more of a greater interest to an entity like this, but this is a really good question of who are they monitoring and how exactly are they going to ensure the quality of waste. So in a lot of the privately owned public toilets, as well as some of these government owned public toilets, there are all sorts of exactions. You must sit, you cannot squat, you can't throw your paper in, you've got to throw it in a different bin, you can't throw trash in the toilet. You know, there are all of these ways in which people are monitored, if not policed, but how is this changing with these new facilities? Or what kinds of adjustments will they have to make in the biogas apparatus if they have impure waste? We want to call it that. In terms of the different ways or the similarities between these kind of sustainable projects, sustainable engineering, sustainable sanitation, in kind of more and less wealthy or industrialized countries. This is of a special interest to me because it's an example of the way kind of the South gets to be used as a crucible for innovation. So in a lot of my research, I'm finding that these public toilet solutions are like way ahead of what the World Bank is envisioning, right? So a lot of it is just, you know, innovation from the South, like Southern solutions to Southern problems. But you also have the case where kind of Southern cities in the global South get to be used as sites of experiment. Just the way, you know, you look at global pharmaceuticals, right? That's the way they operate. Well, these are like willing subjects, right? They're cheap subjects. Life is cheap to some extent. Some of the same things I think are happening here. So on the one hand, we might see like, oh, wow, this is so fantastic. They're really ahead of things. There's going to be biogas electricity production in this city in Ghana before there's biogas electric production in the town where I live in Florida. Or I was telling someone about this project and said, oh, come to me to Brooklyn because we have these giant domes. We've got a special new way we're going to produce methane. So it kind of puts this corner of Ghana on the map of urban innovation, but I still think we really need to look at the different kinds of inequality that make these spaces available for experimentation. And I'm going to go from here, right, into Dorita's question about how does capital play into public authority? Because capital is playing right into the hands of public authority, or public authority is playing right into the hands of capital. So in Ghana, and I don't know if there's anything parallel going on in South Africa, there's a huge decentralization exercise going on in terms of more and more autonomous municipalities are being established. So when I showed that slide early on of my friend Ibrahim Badu, who had been a district assemblyman in Tema, very, very savvy, and then was a leader in this kind of independence movement for Ashaima, one could attribute the success of that movement to, wow, these people really had it together, they knew how to organize, they knew how to assert themselves. But also the government of Ghana, this Ministry of Local Government, had been looking for new municipalities to create because they think it's a way to kind of create greater accountability. It's a political strategy. So you have all these municipalities and they get a certain fund from the national government, but they're really still very hard pressed to provide for their citizenry and they have to come up with solutions. So I've seen in Ashaima myself these delegations of Dutch and Danish and all these kind of international groups who are trying to sell kind of municipal services, whether it's this waste management solution or another waste management solution. And Badu is all ears. He's got to solve this problem. So I think this kind of political restructuring that's going on a national level definitely allows for certain kinds of bargains, relationships, compromises to be struck with capital, which gets to Jonathan is asking about in terms of the moral dilemmas and the moral trade-offs, right? So maybe this is good. Maybe it's gonna produce electricity, maybe it's gonna be a cleaner place. Oh, but why are people paying to deposit their waste, paying for their waste to be removed by this company, and paying again for electricity? So, you know, the winners and losers, and who's really thought through that equation, and where should the accountability be, and is returning this plant in 18 years, when it's outlived its lifespan of usefulness, to the municipality? It's just going to be a brownfield. So, you know, where is the accountability, and what kind, you know, there's a question about what kind of policies, and really, you know, do people realize when they go to the toilet here, right, they're essentially signing a contract, or assenting, consent, not quite consenting, they're not consciously, but they're assenting to a certain set of transactions around their bodily outputs, and a bodily output that actually has value. So should there be informed consent? When I pay for my toilet paper, should I also mark, okay, I'm okay with this, I just really want to go to the bathroom? So these are complexities of modern living, and I think the capitalization of waste is absolutely kind of a worldwide trend. This is Jason Moore is right on target. We need to keep our eyes open. And everything that we think has no value, if we looked at it as if it had value, our world would change very much. So, yeah, that's all there. Yeah.
My name is Akiba. I'm Daniel. And thank you for the presentation. And Ghana has an energy problem, energy crisis here. And this initiative really looks promising, and if everything should, I mean, the outcome should come through, would really go a long way to help the country. I want to find out how sustainable is this initiative, because looking at the political scene in Ghana and how toilets and waste are sometimes hijacked by political parties and things like that, food soldiers and things like that, how sustainable is this initiative?
Right. Okay. So Habiba is referring to competition over public toilets, because public toilets are a very lucrative source of revenue, and so there's a lot of political competition, because public toilets, especially in urban areas, are considered a kind of political spoils. So if you have a mayor or a parliamentarian, or you have whatever political party is in power, they often try to distribute management of the toilets to their followers. So if there's a regime change, then sometimes there's real struggles, there's even violence over these toilets. So yeah, there's a question, if there's certain toilets that are gonna be the supply lines, and then that's upset. But it may also be, do these facilities get kind of privatized? Is it not just the NPP toilet or the NDC toilet, but does it become, oh, this is like, these toilets are transnational toilets. They don't belong to any party. You know, these are like pure toilets. They're just scientific toilets. So that's a question of who's going to control those and how it's monitored. And are there going to be, I mean, we really do have to ask some questions about, like, are they going to be this franchise, right? Are these going to be charade toilets that are then untouchable, and what happens with that? So yeah, there's a very complex politics to the toilet. Now, there is an energy problem in Ghana. And so a lot of Ghanaian electricity is hydroelectric, Akasambo Dam, and then another dam, Gwe Dam, but also Ghana has problems with water levels, rain, et cetera. So there is a trend towards these kind of micro power generators. That can be run on a lot of different sources. So I don't, even though the Ashima project is at a fairly large scale, I think we're gonna see other projects within the country. And there's much smaller experiments with biogas. This one was especially interesting to me in terms of the degree of innovation, the degree of capitalization, and the way in which kind of science was used to kind of infiltrate the kind of urban authorities.
Hi Brenda, I'm from this department. Thank you very much, that's very interesting. But you were saying that they got a grant to improve water and sanitation. So you've touched on sanitation, but I've seen similar model plants where they use the human waste to filter out the water, which after 4 or 5 filtration systems through plants, it's good enough for agricultural use, but then you can filter it a stage or two further to be drinking water. So this reconsumption of water again, which is also, are these companies also coming in with stepping in between with the municipality with the recommodification of water?
I do not, whether, so they've been mostly focused on the organic waste that can be used as fertilizer, but then there's the effluent. At this point, they don't have the capacity to keep filtering it, because even though it's a large plot where they're doing this, the number of settling ponds that is required is much greater. But this is part of discussions that are going on in Ghana, and the person who runs the Tema Municipal Waste Management for liquid waste is well aware of this possibility. It's just about, do you have the space, do you have the technology? There are actually all these sewage settling ponds, but it needs aerators and the electricals were stolen, but there are these conversations that are definitely happening in Ghana. But the water, the reclaimed water from sewage, is definitely a hard sell because of all of this taint that's associated with it. In the same way, the manager of this project is like, oh, all my hard work, now it's just, you know, this electricity that's gone off in the grid. That kind of distance is good for the consumer. Not that there's any kind of noticeable relationship between the source of the power, but if people want clean energy, and if they knew where it came from, that might devalue it. So water is more difficult in kind of sanitizing it in people's heads, as well as making sure it truly is clean. Well, I think Bataille is just so relevant. I mean, you could read, if you read Bataille, Bataille can seem absolutely off the wall, right? That Bataille can really just seem kind of outrageous, ungrounded. What is he really talking about? But then when I came to this, he seemed right on. And this is perhaps a way to, I don't know, it's not exactly reclaiming Bataille, but to kind of maybe repurpose Bataille for something that's a lot more material and grounded. When he's talking about waste and energy, he's kind of talking about excess and display and pleasure. I mean, he does also write about excreta. So it's like, can we like give some real material substance to Bataille? So I think Bataille has a lot to say. I think it kind of opens Bataille in a new way. And I also think it opens Bataille in a new way because he's working at a certain historical moment where there's actually like revolutions in the way energy is made and managed and thought about. It's a certain kind of, it's a scientific break. Is it a kind of post-war economic break? I just think that there's like a, in some way in this kind of recapitalization of nature that Jason Moore is talking about, there may be like a radical revisioning of things. And Bataille has this kind of, he has this sense of radical possibility. So you may be saying like, ease up on the Bataille, but I think the conversation with Bataille kind of opens things up. It maybe puts Bataille in a new light, but it really says this economy of waste, this economy of surplus, excess, and how there's always loss and there's always gain. I think there's something there. You mentioned Antonina von Schnitzler's work, which is also about power and electricity and also the way different apparatus get repurposed. So I see this maybe going an opposite way, because she's looking also at how sort of inherited technologies get popularized and kind of politicized from below. But this is kind of moving the other way, that these inherited technologies kind of get amassed and contained and maybe even corporatized. But her work is certainly very relevant.
Thanks for the great paper, Brenda. I'm very curious about the waste value dialectic.
Yeah.
And I'm wondering if there may be a politics sort of implicit here, whether it's actually concretely articulated on the ground is a different thing, but around kind of thinking about the conversion from waste to energy, and not through money, but stopping it at the point of money, perhaps, and wondering whether there's a kind of publicness to be claimed. Yes, the science is there to make waste into energy, and to, you know, if Ghana indeed does have this massive energy problem, is there politics to be sort of organized around, at least hypothetically, around the possibility of not reconverting it, but rather thinking about its local distribution, redistribution. Is that something that's too utopian even to think about? Is it already, is the science already captured by capital in such a way that the money element of that circuit has to be in it? I was wondering in a sense, prompted in the sense of thinking about the moments of political practice, of publicness that could enter the circuit and could disrupt it or redirect it in a way that might be interesting.
Could as the chair, how many questions have we had? Is it just Bernard's or whatever? Okay, so I'll have one and we'll have a couple more. I mean, do you know around the corner in Nkanini informal settlement, there's been a kind of green fund, Gates Foundation, Sustainability Institute initiative around the ISHAC, which is solar energy, as well as biogas. And both the solar energy and the biogas initiatives got caught up in local politics around not just gatekeeping, that was one element of it, but the fact that Eskom could plug you directly into real energy. You know, so there's a notion that these alternatives don't match up to the power of Eskom. You know, so if you take this energy, so we get into the particularities of South Africa, why these kinds of projects may not be as available. The bioavailability of people is not there because of the kind of histories, the racialized inequalities in terms of access to infrastructure, the expectations of modernity and citizenship and belonging in the new South Africa. We're not going to take your second class
energy or second class alternative toilets or whatever the case may be. We want the real thing. You know, so there's this long history that sort of makes it difficult for this kind of project to land. And it's encountered down the road and in Durban. There's a similar set of frictions. You can take one more comment or question, or
I had another quick one. I think it's connected. That is, I was thinking also the relation between formal and informal, in the sense that at some point you were talking about the waste of waste in terms of the big biodigester. So I was thinking also in terms of that this idea that after waste is commodified, then it's also automatically create waste, so it creates perhaps also an informal economy attached to it. So I was wondering if you can give us a little bit of that side.
Bernard has stumped me because I think we need to talk more about this. Because at this point, it is captured by capital because they really are the only ones with the means to make this kind of investment. But you do bring up this kind of another moral question of kind of what is more tainted? Because in some ways, money is clean, but money can be very tainted. So if you bypass money, maybe you're bypassing the taint. Maybe waste has less taint or kind of moral taint than the money in this case. But I think a lot of it is going to depend, like, okay, is it sustained? Is it scaled up? How much energy is generated? Does it make a difference? What kind of returns will the municipality want? Can the municipality then say, oh, well, yeah, we wrote that MOU, but actually we're going to take this over and boot you out, or, you know, so who knows what's going to happen there. But you can elaborate, or we could have a side conversation about that. But back to Stephen, you're kind of giving me some ideas about things to look for when I return to Ghana. Because, again, the bargain's being struck. The second-class citizens and second-class services. So you're saying people don't want to settle for second-class services. There's quite a bit of choice in terms of toileting in Ashima, but it really depends on how much money you have to spend. If you only have 5 cents, 10 cents, then you're going into the horrible government toilets. If you have more, you're in the lovely flush toilets with the perfume and the TV and, you know, extra clean tile. But one wonders if this company is trying to, they want certain kinds of fecal materials, right? Okay, sure, I'm happy to give that to you, but can you make sure the TV is on my favorite channel and I want your hours to be open in this way and I like this kind, you know, you wonder, like, maybe there's gonna be negotiated for, like, better facilities and who are the people who are gonna do that or who are the people who, I don't know, there's like kind of odd futuristic scenarios, right? It's going to be like a blood bank, right? So, jury is out, but yeah, I'm curious. And even whether they can make the company can make those demands in terms of the kind of waste. Really, like, what are they going to do? They're not going to, like, do fecal testing for everyone who goes to the bathroom. It's too expensive. They're going to just have to take whatever waste they get, take the garbage with the good stuff. So, you know, I have to see how they're contending with that. Davida, formal and informal, in what way? This is a very formal enterprise, but they are going to be working with informal. So there's the government public toilets, there's these NGO public toilets, and then there are private individuals, you might say they're informal, who also have public toilets. Those people have a kind of relationship with their customers. They may be the better suppliers. So
I was wondering what if there's an informal economy around the formal waste economy.
Yeah. Well, I think there already is. And there are other biodigesters. In this Wastelandia area, there's a biodigester that produces electricity that fuels a kitchen in a hostel, and then there's gray water. I mean, there's a much more kind of self-contained, you might say, all of that is informal. Yeah, but I think there's a question about, you know, this company, how is it going to, how might it need to depend on informal suppliers, informal monitors, to make this happen? Yeah.
I'm very struck with the kind of formulation of the private-public toilet, right, and the juxtaposition of so-called informal or different levels of ownership, but
yeah.
not the state of
yeah.
the
yeah.
public toilet. In South Africa, you know, one of the things that I struggled with at one point was trying to think about public transport and how much public transport is owned by all these private operators.
Yeah, yeah.
And I wondered, it's more like a comment. I just thinking about the sovereignty works and responsibility works around these entanglements of these public-private partnerships, not at the level of these massive state projects, which are public-private partnerships as well, but at these
mm-hmm.
at these very local levels, and whether in fact we see a mirroring of the large scale public-private partnership, or whether these take a very different form of the claiming of the public in a certain way, not a kind of hard and angry claim of a common in any sense,
mm-hmm.
but a reading of the public-private.
This also, in terms of, so the whole social contract, right? And what is the state ceding? So the state's monopoly of waste is actually a rather kind of stealth monopoly. You know, like, who knew?
Right.
It's only if you misplace your waste, well, maybe you get a notice, you get a summons, but who knew that the state actually wanted it, right? So I think this is so interesting in terms of like state divestment, like the kinds of responsibilities that it's kind of selling off or given out, and how this becomes like a stealth kind of state claim or state monopoly. So you wonder what else, right? Like, is it gonna then, you know, like, is it gonna be selling the clean air that's looming above Ashima to the, so there's interesting ways in terms of kind of what, I think some of this is about public goods, right? So yeah, there's lots of ways to think through that.
We're at 2:30, unless are there any pressing questions. I think you've worked really hard. You've been with us for a couple of hours this morning, and now you've really given us a lot to think about. Thank you very much.
Thanks so much for having me.